My name is Matt Stutzman, and I am a competitive archer. I'm 32 years old, and I was born in 1982 with no arms. And there's no medical reason for why I was born without arms. The doctor just said that 1 in 200 million people are born without a limb, a toe, a finger, something of that sort. And I just happened to be born without any arms. I was adopted out at a young age, at 13 months old. My parents adopted me and brought me into a family where I have 7 brothers and sisters. The cool thing about my family is that my mom and dad thought that they would never treat me, I guess, special. They would just treat me like the rest of my brothers and sisters, which meant that I had to get up in the morning and carry 5-gallon buckets of feed out to feed the cows and feed the pigs, gather eggs, all the stuff you would do growing up on a farm. One of the things that my parents really pushed me to do was learn how to think outside the box and learn how to adapt to basically any situation that was thrown at me. You know, I love sports, I love outdoors, and the first thing I had to figure out is how I was gonna go hunting. My dad and my brother would take their guns and their bows and they would go out in the woods. And a lot of times I found myself, especially at a young age, on the sidelines, tagging along, watching them have all the fun, because I, at that time, had yet to figure out how to accurately shoot a gun or a bow. With my dad and my brother kind of pushing me to figure things out, I picked up a gun one day, and if I held the stock with my right foot and I pressed it against my right shoulder, I could squeeze off the trigger with my left shoulder. I would stick it in the trigger and I would shoot. Teaching myself to shoot that way turned out to be something that I really grew fond of, and I learned how to do it pretty quickly. And within a matter of months, my mom said that, and I remember vaguely this story, but within months I was shooting pennies at 50 yards with my .22 freestanding, without a tripod, anything like that. And for me, growing up without arms, I just thought that was natural. I just thought people with arms did that. People without arms did that. People just growing up living on farms who are into that thing, that's what they did. And little did I know, I was training myself at that young of age to basically be the best archer in the world. So when I was 16 years old, I talked or conned my dad into basically allowing me to shoot a bow. We had no idea how I was going to do it at the time. I just knew I had a genuine interest in wanting to learn. So I remember going up to the local archery range and walking up to the owner, and basically I said to him, I said, I would like to buy a bow because I am going to use it to shoot a deer. And I remember the look on his face was kind of like, you know, how is a guy without arms gonna shoot a bow? And I guess I never really thought it through either, but being a nice guy that he is, he ended up letting me buy a PSE, and I took that bow home and I taught myself how to shoot. The first thing I did is I'd actually hold the string underneath my right shoulder and I would push my foot out like this. And when I was ready, I would release the string by moving my shoulder out. It worked pretty good, except it's not very accurate, and a lot of deer would get away. And I'm one of those guys who are or like to basically be perfect in what I do. So the next step of learning or teaching myself how to hunt with a bow was I got a release aid, mechanical release aid with a trigger, and I would stick it over my right shoulder on this side right here as far as I could go, and I would hook it essentially like you see me shoot now. I'd hook it onto the string, onto the D-loop, and I would pull back and aim. Now, back when I first started doing that, I had to keep my shoulder straight out like that, because if I would let it creep, the wrist strap would come off my shoulder, and hence causing a lot more issues and missing the deer again. So I have to keep my shoulder straight all the time, and then I would trigger it by using my jaw, and because the trigger would be underneath my right jawbone, and I would go basically like that, and that would shoot the bow. After I got pretty efficient with that, I would how I practice at that is I would take a fishing line and I would put a milk jug out in the yard, and my brother would reel the milk jug across the yard and I would shoot at it. Once I got that figured out and thought I was ready to go, I went out into the woods with my dad and we built this homemade tree stand with a ladder. And back then when I was learning how to shoot, the rests were not evolved into, I guess, what they are now. They just had like this, they were a fixed bladed position. They didn't do full containment or anything like that. So I remember climbing up into my tree stand the very first time I went to go hunting. And I remember this nice buck comes by at the, to me, he was huge. I don't know how big is big. I guess if I would use hand gestures, it might be maybe that big of rack or maybe this big or whatever. But I remember drawing on him, and as I'm drawing on him, the arrow would keep falling off the rest. Hence, missing my deer again. About a half year after learning how to shoot with a rest that my arrow liked to fall off of and things like that, we bought a new rest. I believe it might have been what they call the whisker biscuit. And with that rest, I was able to harvest a couple deer. And I remember one day after I had shot a deer, we had the bow in the back of my dad's truck. And we did not find the deer, came back out, and my bow was gone. And that was at 17 years old. Well, I come from a big family. We didn't have a lot of money, and it took me a long time to talk my dad into allowing me to help me get a bow in the first place. So I basically was out of luck. No more bow hunting for Matt. In 2010, I am now married and I have two boys at the time. It's hard finding work for me at this point, because a lot of people who are in the industry looking for people to work aren't necessarily looking for people without arms. I was on disability, that's how I paid my bills, and we were trying to figure out a way to put food in the freezer before winter. I talked my wife into letting me go out and purchase a bow. We skipped rent just so we could, don't do that, but we skipped rent to purchase the bow, went out and got a bow. That year I was pretty successful, shot a couple deer, once again running the whisker biscuit. I remember that was a Bear Lights Out. That was the bow that I had purchased. In 2011, I went to my very first archery tournament and walked in and remember thinking to myself, wow, I am the only one in here that has no arms shooting a bow. Because I thought everybody without arms shot a bow. But the reality is that I was the only one. I remember shooting the tournament. There was maybe 500 people in this tournament. And I didn't get great placing. I probably placed close to last or something like that, but I was pretty much hooked. 2 days after that tournament, I was contacted by a sponsor who offered to give me some archery equipment, and I was super excited. I talked it over with my wife, and well, let's be honest, he doesn't like free equipment, right? So I took him up on the offer and got my first sponsor, and I'm basically bragging to all my friends and showing them this amazing bow that I just got. And I had a friend who looked me in the eye and he said, Matt, the reason why they sponsor you is because you are the only one in the world that shoots a bow with no arms. And every time you shoot that bow, it draws attention to their product. So they're going to make sales. Not because you're good. And I thought to myself, what a jerk. Why would you say that to me? But then I started thinking about how he's absolutely correct. I'm the type of guy who wants to be known for the best in the world. not a sideshow. Yes, I can use my no arms to, you know, get and gain some great opportunities, but the last thing I want to be known as just the guy who shoots with his feet. I want to be known as the guy who's really good who shoots with his feet. Talk to the wife, and that's when my trek for being the best archer in the world began. 8 hours a day I trained. I started shooting every day. Started Googling how professionals shoot, and I started training and teaching myself all the mental game and the physical part, and how to hold a bow properly and what anchor point means and all this type of stuff. Little did I know it was going to lead up to representing the United States in London and winning a silver medal. So 2011, I get a great opportunity to go see what it's like to be considered on the national team. I remember going down and meeting all the national team members, archery members at the time, shooting my very first tournament and against them. And I remember winning the qualification round by shooting the highest score. My very first time with the national team, earning my spot to represent the United States and compete. In 2012, I go to the trials to see who gets to go to London. I shoot so well, I'm so focused, I shoot so well that by day two, I essentially had enough points that nobody could have caught me, even with all of day three, thus earning my spot to go represent the United States. So in 2012, at the middle or at the end of 2012, I find myself in London. I qualify the number one seed in the world in qualifications, and I make it all the way through all the elimination rounds and end up shooting and winning myself a silver medal. So ever since I started shooting archery, I have completed and accomplished a couple amazing things. I actually have the world record for the longest accurate archery shot. I also hold 4 world records at 50 meters, as well as 1 at 70. Now I currently live in Iowa, and I'm training for Rio, which is coming up according to my calendar on my wristwatch in about 2.5 years. So time is of the essence. If I want to be the best in the world, it's time to get my butt off this chair and go train. We'll see you guys later. Anyway, all right. I just made that up as I went.